Thank you very much. I have to tell you that that was probably the nicest introduction I've ever received. My mom would be proud. I'd just like to say, you know, the problem is choice. Now, I know what you're thinking. Some of you must be thinking, choice is not a problem. Choice is good. And I know we've had a recent choice here in the U.S., and while some of you may not be happy with the way things worked out, and some of you may wish we had better choices, nevertheless, I think most of us here are probably happy that we at least live in a country where we get a choice, as opposed to living in a country where the choice is made for us. So how can choice be a problem? And the answer is, some choices we don't want to make, right? Here's a switchboard operator choosing how to connect phone lines all day. This is something that automation has taken care of, thankfully, and hopefully there aren't any more jobs quite like this anymore. And as radiologists, we make choices, and technologists, by the way, if you're in the audience, we make choices all the time. And some choices we like to make, but other choices I'm sure we wish would be made for us automatically. Now, some choices are obvious. These are the choices that I considered when looking at upgrading our CT scanner. These are frequently numerical choices that are easy to quantify. Such when we wanted to upgrade our scanner, I thought about, well, I'd like to have more detectors, smaller detectors, a larger gantry, and I'd like iterative reconstruction. These are easily quantifiable, and these choices are obvious. And you can see the benefits of these choices quite easily. So here's a patient with an infrarenal abdominal aortic aneurysm, and you can see on our new scanner, the DLP was 364. On our old scanner, same patient, DLP was 1506, which means that we got more than a 75% reduction in dose, and if you look at the image quality, it's comparable, or if anything, it's a little bit better if you look at the paraspinal muscles on our new scanner at the much lower dose. So this kind of decision, easy to make. Similarly, in my practice, we do lots of different kinds of CTs, but we do a lot of coronary CTA, and we can use the dose advantages to get very low-dose coronary CT images. Here's a 42-year-old man who had atypical chest pain. He's a kind of a youngish individual. He's going to be concerned about radiation, and you can see he's got no coronary artery disease, his right coronary artery, circumflex, LAD, beautiful images with just 1.1 millisieverts of radiation. So beautiful images, easy diagnosis to make. What I'd like to spend the rest of my talk talking about are really some choices that are not so obvious. And I didn't even consider any of these when I was thinking about upgrading my scanner. And they revolve around things where you think you know everything already. For instance, both our new scanner and our old scanner have automated bolus detection. They both have a table that moves. They both can adjust the helical pitch. And you can choose when you do a cardiac CT whether you want to do it prospectively or retrospectively. It's the apparent lack of choice that can be an illusion. And again, so the problem is choice. So let's focus a little bit on automated bolus detection, okay? Our prior scanner required the technologist to monitor the bolus and to choose when to start the acquisition. And you can see from this painting what would go through the technologist's mind when we wanted to use automated bolus detection. We almost never used it, despite the fact that we had it on our system for many years. The reason is the technologist needs to monitor the signal over time and make a split-second decision when the signal peaks, and then they need to hit the scan button. And that frequently, the way they hit it made it look a lot like a panic button because they really needed to get it right away if they wanted to get the timing just right. And as a result, on our old scanner, we hardly ever used automated bolus detection. We use something called a test bolus instead. Many of you may use test boluses. The nice thing is, on our new scanner, all of this is completely automated. So the question is, so what? What effect does that have on us? Well, we don't use a test bolus anymore. We use automated detection. And the nice thing about it is that, as a result, we use less contrast, because we don't have to give contrast for a test bolus. And we are able to get through patients much more quickly. The scan time goes down. And the fact that things are more efficient and safer for the patient is something that we really wouldn't have considered when we were choosing to upgrade our scanner. Now, This also led to other changes. Eliminating the test bolus reduced the complexity of the study. Here's just a figure showing what would happen on our old scanner when we wanted to do, say, a coronary CTA. The technologist would do a test bolus. They would need to count the number of points in the curve, multiply them by 2 because they were acquired every 2 seconds. They would need then to add several seconds because the scanner didn't start the instant the injection happened. They would need to add an additional delay, which would vary depending on whether the patient had bypass grafts or not. And all of this complexity is now gone. And basically, it gets rid of choice, which can be a good thing. Now, not all of the time savings is due to getting rid of the test bolus. There are a number of other features that allow us to scan more quickly. For instance, our old scanner operated much like an old typewriter, in the sense that when you typed, you'd hit the carriage return. You type another line, hit the carriage return. Just like our patients, they'd go into the scanner and get scouted, and they'd come back out. Then they'd have to go in again and come back out. The nice thing about our new scanner is that you can see right here, as the patient goes in and you get scouted, why should the patient have to come out to get scouted again? Why not just rotate the tube 90 degrees and then on their way out, do the scout? Now, that's a small feature. It's kind of like having cup holders in your car. Might not be a reason to buy a car, but it sure makes a big difference to have that cup holder there, doesn't it? Other things also save time. For instance, we have immediate reconstruction now on our images. It used to be that a technologist used to have to wait after the scan was done for all the images to be reconstructed before they would get the patient off the table. The nice thing is, on our new scanner, it has this fast recon that literally keeps up with the scanner, so you don't need to wait, and you don't need to make the choice of finding that priority recon button to try and get those last images. You can see literally everything the whole way down. Now, I'd like to share with you a number of diagnostic dilemmas that occurred with us both before and after our upgrade, and show you what the effects were on our workflow. So one of the things, as I said, that we do a lot of is coronary CTA, and one of the questions inevitably would be, which gating protocol do we want to use? And for those of you that don't do a lot of coronary CTA, let me just explain. One protocol is prospectively gated, and that's a nice protocol to use because the patient will get about 70% less radiation. Now you might say, well, why not use that protocol on everybody? And the answer is, it depends on having a regular heart rate, a nice, slow, regular rate, and not everybody has that. And so in those cases, you might want to use retrospective gating. It's a more robust technique, but it comes at the expense of higher radiation. Now, so our technologist is left in the uncomfortable position of choosing to guess. Do they want to give the patient less radiation or have a more robust acquisition? And I would argue that's another choice that nobody wants to make. Why do you want to choose between your patient and the happiness of your radiologist? And you know who's going to win, right? In other words, the technologist is not going to get chewed out by the patient for using the higher dose. There's going to be a bias to using retrospective gating. But what if you don't need to make that choice because it's fully automated for you, as it is now on our new scanner? So what have we observed? We've observed a decrease in retrospective gating, a decrease in radiation dose, because the machine will make the decision for you instead of you having to make the decision yourself. And furthermore, it does one even better. We used to make the decision ahead of time, hoping that we would know what the heart rate was going to look like when the patient was getting injected. But take a look at how smart this machine is. What happens here is, in this patient, it started with a prospective acquisition. The light gray shows that we were only acquiring data in diastole when the heart was still. And then you can see what happens. We got a premature atrial contraction. Now, on our old scanner, we would have acquired data at the wrong spot, and we would have gotten a mismatch in our data. We would have gotten potentially a non-diagnostic study or need to repeat the study at a higher dose and more contrast, and we would have to make that choice. How many times are you left having to decide whether you want to repeat a scan or not? That's a terrible choice to be faced with. The nice thing is the scanner said, whoops, I don't want to acquire this data prospectively anymore. I'm going to acquire it retrospectively, and I'm going to skip this bad heartbeat where the data's not good anymore. And as a result, you get beautiful image quality. In fact, it's so beautiful, we now scan patients we wouldn't scan before. So here's a patient in atrial fibrillation, the mother of all irregular rhythms. And you can see a beautiful right coronary artery, a beautiful circumflex artery, and a non-occlusive or a non-obstructive stenosis of the mid-LAD. So now we don't need to decide whether we want to scan these patients or not before. It's just something that happens automatically. Now, there are other advantages that we see also. For instance, we would have another diagnostic dilemma of what do we do with patients with a high calcium score? There are some places that have set arbitrary limits of what calcium score they won't scan. 1,000 is a common number that people use. And while calcium is still a problem, we find that it's actually less of a problem. You can see in this volume rendered image, this person has these very heavily calcified proximal vessels. The calcium score was 1,800, and yet with our thinner detectors and thinner slices, we can actually still see inside the lumen of these vessels and render a confident diagnosis of non-obstructive coronary disease, even with a calcium score of 1,800. Or how about this dilemma? Where's the cardiac CT technologist? I know there's some of you in this room that have this problem. In the hospitals that I work, we have many CT technologists, but only some of them are approved for doing cardiac CTA. And the problem is this, and this is a true story, except it happened in my office. It's 7 o'clock at night. A patient with chest pain urgently needs a coronary CTA. Can you find a technologist to do the study? And how long can the patient wait? Is that the kind of choice that you want to have to make? Do you want to tell the ER that the patient's stable enough and that they can wait? Or do you want just them to go to the cath lab and have the more invasive test? What if you didn't have to make this choice anymore? So we don't have to make the choice anymore. It's a true study, a true story. This exam was done by a technologist 3 days after we hired her, 3 days after she finished her schooling, having never worked as a CT technologist, 3 days after never having loaded our injector. She not only did it at night, but she did it alone with nobody watching her. And you can see a beautiful study, normal coronary arteries in this young patient with a 1.9 millisievert dose to boot. Wouldn't it be nice if you didn't have to find that CT technologist anymore? And I actually spoke to my technologist. I said, how did you train her so quickly the next morning? I said, how could she learn how to do this so quickly? And she said, well, I actually had extra time because Toshiba actually does our QA for us every month, so I didn't have to do that anymore. Is that ridiculous? Who thinks of these things? All right, last diagnostic dilemma. This one doesn't happen that often, but when it happens, it's a real bummer. A patient has chest pain and intermittent claudication, and the physician requests a coronary CTA and a CTA of the abdomen and both lower extremities. This is one of your best referrers, right? Which test do you schedule first? Because on our old scanner, we would need to choose. We would need to do two injections. We wouldn't want to give that much contrast at one time to a patient. So would we choose to schedule the heart first or the legs first? You don't need to make that choice anymore. Why not? Well, all CT scanners can adjust the helical pitch. All of them can move the table. And all of them can gate the acquisition. So all scanners are the same, right? No, that's an apparent illusion again. It's the illusion of a lack of choice. Because not all scanners can control these functions dynamically during an acquisition. So what I'm saying here is that what the scanner is able to do is the table can move very slowly with a low pitch and gate the heart right here. And then after it's done with the heart, it can change to an ungated mode, which is much faster with a much higher pitch. And so you can do the entire exam with one injection. So what are the advantages of having something like this? Well, a shorter exam time. You've got one instead of two. That means decreased scheduling complexity, a lower contrast dose, a faster time to diagnosis, more convenient for the patient, and improved patient safety, and one less choice from you, which is you don't have to figure out which test to do first. And this is what the images look like. Here's a severe stenosis of a proximal right coronary artery in this patient, and during the same exam, a severe stenosis or occlusion, rather, of a long segment of the right SFA, all from one injection, automatically. So to conclude, technological advances are often quantified by numbers. The number of detector rows, the gantry rotation speed, the image reconstruction speed. You know about all of these things, and these things are important. But what's often neglected, and what I learned, is that the technological advances inevitably increase complexity, and they increase choice. Automation can simplify this process, and when done well, it substantially improves patient care and cost effectiveness. Thank you very much.